Malena canta el tango como ninguna, en cada verso pone su corazón. Ayuyo del suburbio, su voz perfuma. Malena tiene pena de bandoneón. Tal vez allá en la infancia su voz de alondra tomó ese tono oscuro de callejón. ¿O acaso aquel romance que solo nombra cuando se pone triste con el alcohol? Malena canta el tango con voz de sombra. Malena tiene pena de abandonar. Tu canción tiene el frío del último encuentro. Tu canción se hace amarga en la sal del recuerdo. Yo no sé si tu voz es la flor de una pena. Solo sé que al rumor de tus tangos, Malena, te siento más buena que yo. Tus tangos son criaturas abandonadas que cruzan sobre el barro del callejón. Cuando todas las puertas están cerradas y ladran los fantasmas de la canción, Malena canta el tango con voz quebrada. Malena tiene pena de abandonar.
Good evening, everyone. We are featuring the tango, Malena. It's one of the most well-known tango and one of the most beautiful tango, and it has a lot of myth around it. Perhaps the version that is recorded by Troilo and in the voice of Francesco Fiorentino are more well-known, but this version also is very beautiful. And I chose this version by Lucio Demare because he's also the composer. Lucio Demare, as you can tell from the name, son of Italian immigrant. He was born in the neighborhood of Abasto, pretty much in the center of Buenos Aires, as you can see here. Also very well known because there is a big market. There used to be a big market. Now that building is converted into a shopping center. But this is a neighborhood where also Troilo was born. His father even had carniceria, the meat shop there, butcher there. Anyhow, Demare's father was a musician as well. And since he was a child, no, very, very little, he had inclination towards music and he studied piano. He could play other instruments, but his profession was with the piano. He debuted first as a jazz musician. Then he got a gig at a cabaret. And what else were they playing in a cabaret in the 20s? Of course, tango. So he fell in love. He wanted to be a tango musician. I'm not sure if you remember the story, but then on the opposite side of the bandstand was a tango band, Francisco Canaro. And he's like, oh, you know, one day I would like to play with you. And he's like, what are you talking about? You don't know how to play tango. You are just a musician. You know, you have nothing to do with this beat. But then Canaro needed somebody. And so in 1926, the chance came. He was only 19, but Canaro took him as a pianist to Paris. There was a long tour in Europe and then Demare was taken there. Now there is first boost of Demare's career came with Tori Argentino. Irusta and Fugasot. You can see the three of them here dressed up in this gaucho costume, no? They were a sensation in Europe. They also played as a part of Canaro's orchestras, but also they were debuted as this trio. And you can hear their music like this.
Bandoneón, arrabalero, viejo fuelle desinflado. Te encontré como un pebete que la madre abandonó. En la puerta de un convento, sin revoque en las paredes, a la luz de un farolito que una noche.
Very lovely, smooth, very simple music. Yeah, it's a recording from 1929. It was recorded in Madrid, actually. They spent a lot of time in Paris and then also a lot of time in Spain. They toured around, and the other thing they also got was a movie. They were featured in two movies called Boliche and Aves en Rumbo. And in there was something magical happened. Not only that they had success as musicians, but Lucio Demare had a brother who didn't know what he wanted to do. So he trained to play bandoneon. So he incorporated him to the musician. But he opened his eyes when he was accompanying Lucio Demare in the filming of Boliche, the movie Boliche. He loved that process of movie making. So he ditched bandoneon, the brother Lucas Demare, and said, you know what, this is what I want to do. So he stayed in Spain, studied, you know, he was this boy running errands, but trying to learn about filmmaking. The gig ended, so Lucio Demare and Natorio Argentino came back to Argentina. Also, that was a time when the civil war was starting in Spain, so it was not really safe to stay there. And the musical venues were not really successful during the wartime, no? So they, once they came back, a few years they worked together, but then they separated. And then that's when Demare started his own orchestra. Demare said that from 1940 to 50, no, 1938 to 48, that 10 years was the most successful time as his orchestra, and it's the best time that he remembers in his life. It was an interview later in his life. The first singer that Demare found was this guy, Juan Carlos Miranda, because remember in the golden age, you needed to have a singer. Before it was more instrumental and it was this chansonnier that sang a little tiny little bit of parts of the song. But then in 1938, in the 40s, it was more important that you have a good successful singer. So this young boy at that time, no? Rafael Miguel Sciola, obviously, again, Italian immigrant's son. He was born in a small town of Chivilcoy, 100 miles west of Buenos Aires, right here. But then he moved to Buenos Aires when he was 18 and started studying singing in Padi. Padi was this music school that Rubinstein brothers had. As you can see here, Rubinstein was also a very famous composer and also lyricist. Yes, and many, many musicians came out of there. Not only that they trained them, but one of the things that they did a lot was to hook them up with gigs. No, they had, because Rubinstein was completely immersed in this world of tango. So you would hear, oh, so and so orchestra is looking for a singer. Like, oh, why don't you go and audition there? No, so they were also sort of working like an agent. Yeah? And in that time, Miranda also won a radio splendid contest. So there was a proof that he could actually sing. So Demare tested him. But he didn't want to tell him that it was for the position of the orchestra singer. So he used his brother, who was already in the movie industry, and said, okay, just do the audition. Just say that it's for the movie or something. But anyhow, he sang. And it's like, okay, good. Okay, let's get him. So Miranda debuted. And you heard some of the songs yesterday, Ding Dong, no? Sorbos Amargos, beautiful song. And this, the iconic song, Malena. Miranda had a great, great success with Demare as an orchestra, singer of the orchestra, but then he decided to leave. I don't know what he was thinking, and he tried to be a solo and sang with another orchestra. Didn't work. In the 90s, somebody found him and he was working as a barber. And that was the end of his career. That's really, really sad, no? Especially considering what a beautiful song that he left with Demare. And then Demare had Verón, Laur Verón, for 1 year. Verón sang with many different orchestra. But then after 1 year, he left. So he had to find another one. That's when this guy, Horacio Quintana, real name is Ramón Domingo Gutiérrez, came in. He was born far, far away. Sorry, I forgot to put a map on here. In Teodelina, Santa Fe. And then when he was young, the family moved to Córdoba, which is a little bigger city, but again, interior of the Argentina, and moved to Buenos Aires in 1942. And the Agustín Irusta, who was the partner of Demare in Torio Argentino, heard him sing. And thought, oh, Demare is looking for a singer, like he would be a good fit. So he introduced him. Even though they separated, they stayed in good terms. And so Horacio Quintana became the singer for Demare. You can see in this rare picture of the orchestra here, Quintana is right here. And Demare on the piano. And, but only he also sang for 2 years and Demare had to break up his orchestra because the Torio Argentino was reuniting and made a recording in 1946. The other side of Demare that is not so known is that he kept playing music even when the tango, the orchestra time or the golden age went down. We'll talk about that. That decline in a different episode, but I would like to introduce this phase of Demare. He recorded this beautiful piano solo album in 1957. And then later he opened Tangueria. Tangueria was a place that is like, I don't know how to call that in English right now. It's a small venue where we could listen to music and have a glass of wine or any other alcohol that you would wish. It was not for dancing, no? Or small formation, no? Because all the other venues that all the musicians were hired, they were disappearing because there were less people listening to this, and then there were a lot of political pressure as well. Anyhow, so he opened one, Cocambalache, actually, with Tania, the singer, remember, the girlfriend or the wife of Discepolo, and then that didn't work, and so he opened another one, con Tangueria Lucio, in 1965, that also didn't work so well. His partner was Libertad Lamarque, actually, another singer. And then later in 1969, he finally found his happy place, con Malena del Sur. It was in San Telmo. And like, as you can see, he used his most iconic song as the name of the bar that he owned. He himself played music. This is the picture of himself playing the piano in Marina del Sur. We played this a little bit earlier, but let's listen to Demare's, his own composition, Marianita de Montmartre, that he composed when he was very young, but this is the solo album that he recorded in 1957. Obviously not for dancing, but this sentimental feeling that we always talk about in tango is still there. Yeah. He passed away in 1974, and it was a big news in Buenos Aires. And of course, the newspaper would say the author of the tango Marena. This song was that much iconic. This quote from Demare's interview in 1974, right before he passed away, summarizes, I really love what he says here. He said, "Today, the Buenos Aires citizen does not keep the features of that tango fan of my time," meaning from the 40s, no? The golden age. "Tango has to be understood, and that happens at least when you're 45 years old. It is a time when you begin to see that tango has something, things that you're experiencing and start to hurt you." We have heard something similar in other musician too, that, you know, tango is really about life, and he says that here. And those of you who are younger than 45, well, you know, you've got something to look forward to as you age. And those of us who are over 45, well, I'm not 45 yet. Anyhow, those of you who are over 45, there you go, congratulations. You're getting the meaning of tango and life. Now, Demare is known as musician, but also more so as a creator, composer of tangos. He wrote so many, but Marena probably is his best work. And here I'm listing several of his famous tangos that we still dance to, no? All of these are actually collaboration with this genius poet, Homero Manzi. Let's listen to some of these songs. Last time when we talk about Demare Verón, we looked into Tal vez será su voz. No? It was like this.
Tal vez era el rumor de aquella que una vez de pronto se dormía. Tal vez era su voz, tal vez su voz no puede ser. Su voz se apagó, tendrá que ser nomás mi propio corazón.
It was also a collaboration with Demare Mansi. Now, this one.
Ella floreció bajo la luna. Ella renació para mi afán. Juntos sin angustia, sin reproche, sin pasado, noche a noche, aprendimos a soñar.
Sung by the other singer, Horacio Quintana, second singer. Malena, like we said, is sung by Miranda, the first singer of the Demare. And all these songs are not only recorded by Demare, but also by other important orchestras such as Troilo, Di Sarli, etc., etc. So I recommend you also to listen comparing those two. Now let's talk about this important and main character of this tango, Homero Manzi. He was born Homero Mancione in 1907 and passed away really young at 43 years old. He was born in Añatuya, Santiago de Estero, north of Buenos Aires. In the interior, that's the region where Chacarera was born, for example. But he moved when he was very little to Pompeya in the sur, in the south, southern, more working class part of Buenos Aires. And he was very well educated, so he became Spanish and literature teacher in the university. But from the influence from his father and also of the time, he was very politically active. And so he got fired at the university job. And so he had to find another way to make a living. And he's been already writing poetry, since he was young. But then this tango starting to become actually a way to make a living. He was very well connected to all the talents, such as Sebastian Piana, who was a pianist and also a famous composer. With him, they revived the milonga, which we talk about next week. And also with Troilo. With Troilo thought of him like a brother. And they had a very important spiritual connection and created many iconic tangos together. Homero Manzi got married and had a kid, Acho Manzi. He has given a lot of interviews. If you look on YouTube, actually, you can even listen to his son talk. But the son says, you know, my father, he was a man of love, like. Apparently, he doesn't look particularly very attractive to me, but anyhow, he had a lot of rumors with women. And Troilo also, or Demare, also said that, oh, he would give like compliments to women and whatnot. And I think part of the reason why there's so much myth about this tango Malena is maybe because he was saying all kinds of things all over the place. The story of this tango goes like this. Something happened and then Manzi wrote the poem first and then gave it to Demare. This has happened with Solamente Ella also. Apparently that's the style that Manzi works, no? He's a perfectionist. He would focus and he would write it, and then he gave it to Demare. And Demare actually lost that piece of paper that he wrote, and then Mansi was like, "Hey, what happened to the song that I gave you, Malena?" And he's like, "Ah, yeah, I'm working on it. Just wait a little bit." And he forgot where he put it, so he had to look for all of the suit pocket that he might have put it into, and finally he found it. I said, "Oh my God, whew. Now I have to write it. Now write the songs." I was like, "Okay, ooh, these are really good lyrics." And so Demare focused. He went down to the cafe downstairs from where he lived, legend says, and wrote it in 15 minutes. And then later he had to perform in the cabaret in downtown. So he went there, and he even already debuted that song with the singer Miranda. And then he tweaked it, with Mansi that night to make sure that this is it. And that was it. Sometimes the amazing thing is born in a very short time. Huh? Now, so that was happened in 1949. And in January, in Tango creation, December, January is a very important time. Why? Because Carnaval happens in February, and that is the biggest season of the year. And so, like, there are a lot of great songs that are created and recorded in January, December time, so they can play it in the Carnival time. Yeah. So 1942 comes, and in January, Troilo Fiorentino recorded it first. And then Demare Miranda recorded 2 weeks later. And then the score was published even after that. Those two even recorded it before the official score, the musical score was published. And then a few months later, Azucena Maizani, a female singer, recorded it. And then this song was featured in this movie called El Viejo Ucha in April. This movie was, guess who directed the movie? Lucas Demare. Who is that? The brother of Lucio Demare, who was inspired at Lucio Demare's filming of Boliche, Spanish movie. And guess who was writing the script of the movie? Ta-da! Homero Manzi. Homero Manzi also had an important career as a film script writer, and also the theater as well, but they collaborated together a lot. And of course, Lucas Demare, when you make a movie, you need to have some emotional elements added with the music. Who makes the music? Lucio Demare. So Lucio Demare on the side is a career as a movie soundtrack composer. This movie was a predecessor. This movie is actually not very good movie as itself, but then after that, in December, was released this La Guerra Gaucha, Gaucho's War, by the same cast, no? Basically made by the same team. And this was considered to be one of the most important Argentine movies. So it was not just a movie maker, but Lucas Demare was an important filmmaker. I would like to share the scene of this movie. Let's see. Where Osmardo Miranda, the actor, sings, but he's voiced over by Juan Carlos Miranda, the actual singer of Demare. It happens in a cafe, and you can notice now that there's a palco. Palco is like a balcony up there where the musician played, and people are on downstairs so they can listen to the music and then see the musician well. It's in a cafe. This was how the cafes of Buenos Aires look like. It was a place where you can hang out for a long time with just the price of coffee, which was really cheap, and listen to music and socialize, play some dice, read newspaper, et cetera, et cetera. It was a very important social place.
En este ansiado momento de mi deber, Voy a ofrecerles el estreno de un tango hijo de mi pobre inspiración. Vale. Arriba, muchachos.
Malena canta el tango como ninguna y en cada verso pone su corazón. Ayuda del suburbio, su voz perfuma. Malena tiene pena de bandoneón. Tal vez allá en la infancia su voz de alondra como ese tono oscuro de callejón. ¿O acaso aquel romance que solo nombra cuando se pone triste con el alcohol? Malena canta el tango con voz de sombra. Malena tiene pena de bandoneón. Tu canción tiene el frío del último encuentro. Tu canción se hace amarga en la sal del recuerdo. Yo no sé si tu voz es la flor de una pena. Solo sé que al rumor de tus tangos, Malena, te siento más buena. Más buena que yo. Tus ojos son oscuros como el...
You can even watch the entire movie on YouTube. And I will post a link as usual on the Facebook group. Now, the question that everybody asks, and there are so many documentaries and so many articles about this, who is Malena? And there are a lot of theories. And one was this very famous singer, Nettie Omar, this beautiful lady right here. She was alive until very recently. And she had a rumor with Mansi, and she herself in the interview later admitted like, oh, I am the Malena, I am the Malena. In case people don't know what she sounds like this. This is a recording from 1946. Orchestra, no, for the dancing orchestra, there are not many female singers except for the one Rita Morales that sang for Edgardo Donato. But it's not true that there was no female singer at all. Of course, there are a lot of female singers. They perform a lot on movies and also in the theaters. And there were a lot of tango recordings just for listening, but not necessarily for dancing. And Nettie Omar was one of those. And the recording that we just listened to, the Adios Pampa Mia, is by the orchestra of Francisco Canaro. So there was that rumor. And then there is that same number of rumor as there is as many female singers there are, seems to be. Now, so the other singer, also very famous and very talented, is Azucena Maizani. She might not be very pretty. She dressed often as men, no? And modeled after Gardel, they say, and but sang in this beautiful, beautiful voice. And this song that we're going to listen to, Pero Yo Sé, is also composed and written. The poem is written by her.
Llegando la noche, recién te levantas y sale tu mano a buscar un pegué. Lucís con orgullo tu estampa elegante, sentado muy muelle en tu regia bajé. Paseas por corriente, paseas por Florida, te das una vida mejor que un payá. De regios programas tenés a montones, con clase y dinero de todo tendrás.
So that was another theory, but apparently it is not. There are so many contradictory stories, but it seems right now the conclusion, what we all agree on, is this. There was a singer, the artist named Malena de Toledo. Her real name was Elena Tortolero. And again, there were so many, oh my God, theories. But the thing is that the Mansi was traveling. We don't know why, and we don't know exactly where, but it seems that he heard her voice in Brazil, in a cabaret. Some people say that they were in layover, or some people say he was there to negotiate the deal for the film. We are not sure. When we say layover, in those times, obviously, they were traveling on ship, right? There was no commercial air flight yet in the 1940s. Some people say he was going to Mexico or coming back from Mexico and he stopped by in Brazil. Some people say it was in Porto Alegre or São Paulo or Rio de Janeiro. We don't know. But anyhow, the legend goes that he was there and then he heard this voice that captured him, that almost haunted him and got inspired. Malena. Malena, okay. Demare tells this story that Mansi has this habit of working from a title first. He will think of the title, and once he gets the title, and he writes the whole song like this. In this case, it was very easy because he was walking on the street, and then there was this cartel, this advertisement said, "Tonight sings Malena in this boate, in the cabaret." Malena, boom, like that's it. That already made the story. She was Argentinian, but living in Brazil because her parents moved to Porto Alegre, and so she grew up there. Although she came back to Buenos Aires, he even sang for Bardaro Pugliese, which didn't record, very sad, and then later returned to Brazil. So the theory is that she was back in Brazil after singing in Buenos Aires, and that's when Mansi heard her. Later, she married a very famous bolero singer, Genaro Salinas. And this is her when she was older. This is her when she was young. And we all want to know what the voice of Malena sounds like. Apparently, there is a recording. It's backed by Orchesta Típica Gentile, orchestra from Uruguay. And this is a tango, Volvé, with the voice of Malena de Toledo.
Desde que te fuiste del cotorro ando tan triste, si supieras que no tengo para nada voluntad, todo lo veo empañado. De tanto como he llorado,
Ya no hay en mi pecho para el daño que me has hecho, te lo juro, ni un chiquito de rencor, ten caridad. Cada vez te quiero más y yo sin tus caricias de vivir no soy capaz. Volvé, mira, volvé y engáñame nomás, no te molestaré con celo jamás. Vos serás como vos quieras para todas las mujeres y yo no pensaré si me engañas o no, pero a mi lado volvé, volvéme a mentir o me matarás. He de vivir sin vos, no soy capaz.
There was a time that she was living in Buenos Aires and she listened to this song that was played by Demare without knowing that the song was about her, apparently. Now, having her voice, let's look into the lyrics and see what you think. Malena canta el tango como ninguna. Malena sings the tango as no one else can. And she pours her heart into every verse. En cada verso pone su corazón. A yuyo del suburbio su voz perfuma. Malena tiene pena de abandonión. Her voice is scented with suburban weeds, no, like the grass that is growing. Malena feels the pain of the abandonión, that her voice is scented with suburban weeds. That's where this magic of Mansi comes. They were saying that the Mansi really heightened the lyrics of tango into the level of poetry. And this song is really one of those examples. Tal vez allá en la infancia su voz de alondra tomó ese tono oscuro de callejón. Perhaps in her distant youth, her lark's voice took on that dark back alley tone. ¿O acaso aquel romance que solo nombra cuando se pone triste con el alcohol? Or perhaps it was the affair she won't speak of unless she saddens herself with alcohol. And I think this line of the affair that she won't, it's a secret affair unless she's drunk, no? Is the part that the rumor with Nelly Omar started. But Nelly Omar's voice doesn't sound like this dark back alley tone. No? Imagine in this little port, no, traveling abroad after a long journey on a ship in a different country, in a distant country, and you hear your country musician's voice, very emotional. Malena canta el tango con voz de sombra. Malena tiene pena de abandonión. Malena sings the tango with a shadowy voice. Malena feels the pain of the abandonión. I'm not sure if you relate that with the singer Malena de Toledo that we just heard. Of course, the recording quality is not very good from the old recording, but we can imagine, no? Or maybe just Mansi was inspired and then created a story from there, from that experience, from that night. Tu canción tiene el frío del último encuentro. Your song carries the chill of the last goodbye. Tu canción se hace amarga en la sal del recuerdo. I love this line. Your song is bitter as the salt of memories, because, you know, you remember and then you cry and then that salt, no? Like a bitter sadness, yeah? Yo no sé si tu voz es la flor de una pena. I don't know if your voice is the bloom of a wound. Solo sé que al rumor de tus tangos, Malena, te siento más buena que yo. I just know the sound of your tangos, Malena, makes me feel that you are better, better than me. This is another part that is very poetic. No? I just know the sound of your tangos makes me feel that you're better, better than me. Tus tangos son criaturas abandonadas que cruzan sobre el barro de callejón. Now the dark callejón back alley comes back. No? Your tangos are abandoned creatures crawling through the back alley mud. Cuando todas las puertas están cerradas y ladran las fantasmas de la canción. When all the doors are closed and the ghosts of songs begin to weep. So it's not just about beautiful thing, it's about the darkness of where it comes from. This word barro, no, this mud and this callejón and all of that from the arrabal, no, from where the tango is from. All of this image keeps coming back to tango, and that is definitely the scenery that he painted. In the voice of Malena that he listened to and got inspired to. It is said that he heard her song and he got inspired, went back to his room, and by the next morning, he already had the poem written in a piece of napkin, which he gave to Demare that he almost lost. You know? Let's listen to the song. Oh, sorry, Malena canta el tango con voz quebrada. Malena sings the tango with a broken voice. Malena feels the pain of bandoneon. Again, he keeps describing her voice, how she sang, no? The pain of the bandoneon with a broken voice, the shadowy voice. No, this is it. Let's listen to the song again.
Now, the quiz time.
I have the poll right here. There you go, which polling. So today, since it's such an important poet, I would like you to find Homero Manzi. This is somebody like you need to recognize by the face. No? And all of these poets are actually very important. And we keep listening to their songs all the time. They created great, many songs. Yeah, okay. This is too easy. Okay, you guys are doing great. I'm gonna end polling because it's too like, okay, everybody got it. Yes, number five is Homero Manzi. Very good. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm not sure if you can tell any other people. One. Oops. Number one was Cadícamo, Flores, Espósito, José María Contursi, another guy with a lot of love stories.
Di Sepolo.
We also know about his love story too. So, you know, you cannot separate this. Okay. Now, let's move on to the next. Sorry. This is wrong. How do I change? Oh, okay.
Is that Troilo?
There we go.
Oh, yes.
So there are three musicians right here, number one, number two, number three. Who is Demare? Okay, great. Okay, good job. Yes, you guys all got it. Fantastic. Number three, this thick eyebrow, you know, Italian descent, is Demare, Lucio Demare. Number one is obviously?
Troilo.
Number two?
Guess
Donato.
Donato, yes, yeah. This like round glasses gives it away, no? It is Donato, very good. Now, the last one is which musicians, why isn't this picture not showing? Okay, which of these musicians, I'm so not understanding how to use this poll, sorry. There we go. Which of these musicians, Demare didn't collaborate with?
I think it's, maybe just, is it Desarmi
or Okay, there are many different ways to collaborate, yeah? You can play for them or they might have played for him or maybe he has provided the songs that he composed to them so they recorded it. Let's see. Poll didn't go. Poll did go, sorry. Share results. Okay. So it was divided between three and four. It's a little tricky, no?
I don't remember.
The answer is D'Arienzo because Canaro, he hired Demare to be the pianist and then he took him to Europe, remember? And Troilo recorded so many of his songs. Malena, Tal vez eras vos, so many. Bizarre also recorded his song, Mañana Zarpa un Barco, was Demare's composition. Yeah, but D'Arienzo had nothing to do with him. So there we go. It was a little tricky question, and I'm sorry, I don't know why his photo is not showing here. But that's it for today. Oh, there we go. This is it.
Great.